Questions asked, and we've tried to answer as many as possible in those two webinars. Continuing on the same vein, we'll have the third webinar for more sicker patients of COVID-19. So we'll talk about critically ill patients and how to manage them in ICU and how to give them ventilatory support. This will again be followed by a question and answer session where we'll try to answer as many questions as possible. So I request you to keep sending your questions on live chat on YouTube, and we'll collate these questions and try to answer them at the end of the two talks. And also this YouTube link will be available on the same site. It's for those who have not been able to join us live. So you can also inform your colleagues to have a look at this webinar later on. So without much ado, let me go on to the first talk by Dr. Dalim, who is from the Department of Anesthesia and Critical Care. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the AIIMS COVID-19 webinar series. So today we'll be discussing the various aspects of critical care management of these patients with severe COVID-19 disease. So in the first talk, I'll be discussing about the management of critically ill COVID-19 patients in the ICU. As you all know, that by this time when I'm delivering this talk, over 8 lakh people have been affected all over the globe, and the death reaching 40,000. There is an urgent requirement of the ICU and hospital contingency plans being in place. The available data so far from China and other European countries suggests that around 10 to 15% of the COVID-19 patients affected reach hospital and require hospital admission. And 5% of the patients will be requiring ICU beds with mechanical ventilation. So in a country with such a huge population like in India, this 5% in absolute terms will reach many, many thousands of patients. And there is an urgent need that we gear up and have our contingency plan, management plan in place. At the same time, the clinician, the healthcare provider should be ready and equipped with the knowledge and skills to deal with these patients. So we should have the important hospital and ICU admission criteria in place so that we can, you know, judiciously use the resources to tackle with this situation in the long-term basis. So first, we need to know whom to admit in the hospital. So if you get a patient who is a COVID suspect, if the patient is having a mild disease, he can actually be managed in home quarantine or in isolation facilities developed by the various governments. But a patient who is having moderate to severe disease, like patients who has tachypnea of respiratory rate more than 24 per minute or oxygen saturation decreasing to 94% or less on room air, PaO2 FiO2 ratios of less than 300, or if they have signs of hypoperfusion like low blood pressure, altered mental status. So those group of patients will require urgent hospitalization. At the same time, there are a few population who will be at risk of developing severe disease even if they present with mild disease. So this kind of population will also warrant admission to the hospital, like age more than 60, diabetic, hypertensive, significant cardiovascular disease, immunocompromised patients, or those suffering from chronic lung disease or renal or hepatic disease. Now, how do we manage these hospitalized patients? So since the COVID-19 predominantly affect the respiratory system, most of the patients admitted will be hypoxic. And you'll need oxygen to provide oxygen saturation to in the range of 92 to 96%. So you can use either simple face mask or nasal cannula to achieve that. However, the patients who deteriorate will need use of high flow nasal cannula or non-invasive ventilation devices. We should be a bit selective and cautious about the use of these high flow nasal cannulas and NIVs. More important is that during the time of hospitalization, this patients should be monitored very closely and vigilantly so that you identify the set of patients who are going to develop severe hypoxia and decide on their intubation and urgent ICU transfer. At the same time, the other management principles remain same, like treating the comorbid conditions, obtaining a blood culture, and starting empirical antibiotic therapy. Regarding fluid strategy, we should be conservative at the beginning so that hypervolemia and flooding of the lungs should not occur in these patients. Now, coming to the ICU admission criteria, the patients will become eventually intubated and require mechanical ventilation or non-invasive form of mechanical ventilation. Hemodynamically unstable patients requiring vasopressor support, worsening of mental status or developing any other organ dysfunction. This group of patients will require ICU admission. At the same time, we need to identify the factors which poorly prognosticate. For example, increase in the age, lymphopenia, high neutrophil lymphocyte ratios, rise in the level of LDH, D-dimers and ferritins. So available data suggests that the people who will have this kind of issues are more likely to have adverse outcomes. So we need to be very, very careful about them. Now it's very important that we have the airway management protocol in place in the ICU. So the group of patients who are developing moderate to severe hypoxia and require intubation, you should follow a fixed protocol. So here it is. We pre-oxygenate the patient first for 3 to 5 minutes and with the use of closed circuit devices. Try to avoid use open circuits or ambu bag and mass ventilation as far as possible. If you have to use open circuits, always place an HME filter above the mask, between the mask and the circuit, so that you will reduce the contamination of the exhaled air coming out. The induction should always be rapid sequence induction. Use either etomidate or propofol depending on the hemodynamic status. Use succinyl choline or rocuronium for the muscle relaxation. You should use good dose of this muscle relaxant so that patient is fully relaxed and you have an easy intubation during the intubation attempts. It's very, very important that the experienced operator attempts intubation. So you should devise your roster in such a way that an anesthesiologist is present in each shift during the all working hours. Regarding the gadget, prefer to use video laryngoscope devices rather than the simple direct laryngoscopes, because in various studies, video laryngoscopes have found that it increases the first attempt success rate as well as the overall intubation success rate. So here are the few video laryngoscope devices which are easily available in the market. So if you do not have these video laryngoscopes already in your armamentarium, please purchase and get them so that you have easy intubations during the pandemic if your ICUs are full of patients who require intubation and mechanical ventilation. The second important principle is that we should avoid aerosols as far as possible. This is mostly because of the concern of safety of the healthcare providers in the ICU and hospital wards. So avoid nebulization as far as possible. Prefer metered dose inhalers. And the patients who are on ventilators, always use HME filters and do not change the HME filters unless it is soiled or it's almost 5 to 7 days. The routine change of ventilator circuits is strongly discouraged, and change the circuit only when it is visibly soiled. Avoid all sorts of circuit disconnections. And if you at all have to do some circuit disconnection because of it is unavoidable, always clamp the endotracheal tube first and put the ventilator on standby mode before you disconnect the circuit. Regarding suctioning, open suctioning method is strongly discouraged. Use the closed suction catheter system so that you can suction without generating any aerosol. So here is the picture of a closed suction device. You have to connect the closed suction device end through the endotracheal tube or the tracheostomy tube, and circuit will be attached through a separate route, and the suction catheter will be continuously in place. Whenever you need to do the suctioning, you unlock the device here and insert the suction catheter, do the suctioning and lock it back again. So this is the way you should use a closed suction device system in these patients. Now, ventilation strategy, we have a separate talk on that, so I will not waste time. And come back to straight away hemodynamic management. So what data do we have so far in the hemodynamic instability of shock in COVID patients? So far, the majority of the data from China show that around 1 to 5% of the cases develop shock, but in admitted ICU patients, around 1/3 develop shock or hemodynamic instability. Predominantly, the shock is septic shock. However, many of the patients may have cardiogenic shock. You have to keep it in your mind, because the cardiac injury was found in around 7 to 23% of patients in Chinese studies. Whereas in one of the studies from China, they reported the cause of death to be shock or myocarditis in as high as 40% of the patients in ICU. However, good robust data is not available. We do not yet know what are the risk factors for development of shock in these patients, or if they develop shock, what is the prognosis, or if early identification of underlying myocardial injury or myocardial dysfunction based on biochemical parameters like troponins or echocardiography, do they affect the prognosis of these patients? We do not know. So basically, we need more evidence on the hemodynamic management of these patients. Meanwhile, the management, what we'll do, the hemodynamic management is basically extrapolated from our experience of non-COVID. So whenever you have stroke volume variation or pulse pressure variations available, always use this data to titrate the fluid therapy in your patient. Do not administer any exogenous fluid challenge. Try to use passive leg raising test as far as possible and interpret in the context of your patient's clinical status and decide on further fluid therapy. Now, other important parameters like lactate should be used quite often. The initial lactate level and the lactate clearance have already been found to be very handy in the resuscitation of these patients. However, if you are using a lactate clearance, remember that there are certain other conditions which will increase your lactate levels falsely, and that might confound the use of lactate clearance data in the resuscitation of your patient. Another important clinical test which you can use is the capillary refill time. The Andromeda shock trial has shown us that the use of capillary refill time in the resource-limited setup, use of this easy bedside test which can be repeated every 30 minutes, is very, very important and even outperforms the routine use of lactate clearance in terms of the survival of the patients are concerned. Now, the next question comes, how much fluid you need to administer? Well, the answer is quite straightforward. We need to use the conservative fluid strategy over liberal fluid strategy, because there is enough data and subsequent meta-analysis of the randomized controlled trial performed consistently so that conservative fluid strategy in a patient who is suffering from sepsis with ARDS significantly reduces the length of ICU stay and length of mechanical ventilation days. So always choose conservative fluid strategy. Do not go by the blanket 30 ml per kg of fluid resuscitation, which is usually advocated in other septic shock resuscitation scenarios. So the WHO recommends that you use 250 to 500 ml of crystalloid bolus maximum in 15 to 30 minutes time and continuously assess and reassess the patients and decide on further fluid administration strategies. Now, the next question is, which fluid? The obvious answer is crystalloids. We have enough data to tell that colloids, particularly the hydroxyethyl starches, are detrimental to your kidneys. There is increased incidence of kidney dysfunctions and renal replacement therapy requirement in septic patients who have been giving colloids freely. Increase in the transfusion requirements is there, and few studies even mortality were increased. Moreover, in the resource-limited setting, colloids may not be available always as well. It's costly. So you always prefer to use the crystalloids. Now, among the crystalloids, try to use Ringus lactate or Ringus acetates, these balanced crystalloid solutions, more often than using the normal saline, because the data from septic shock patients say that the normal saline in fact can cause kidney dysfunction and increase in the RRT requirements, and they can also cause hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. So we prefer to use balanced crystalloid solutions in fluid resuscitation. Next comes the role of vasopressors and the inotropes. So the target blood pressure, mean arterial pressure target, is 65 mm of mercury, and you should be using noradrenaline as your first vasopressor of choice. There is no doubt about it. If noradrenaline is not available to you, then you can use vasopressin or adrenaline as the first choice. However, in a patient who is requiring escalating dose of noradrenaline, maybe more than 15 mics per minute or so, you should add a second vasopressor agent. And vasopressin is the second line vasopressor of choice in these circumstances. However, you should be well aware of the significant side effects arising out of these vasopressors. Tachyarrhythmias are uncommon with norepinephrine. However, it can happen quite commonly with adrenaline, and the increase in the lactate levels will prevent you using the lactate clearance data in the resuscitation if you are using adrenaline. Beware of the digital ischemia as well if you are using higher dose of vasopressin. Now, regarding dopamine, the message is quite loud and clear. There is class 1 evidence that dopamine should not be used in such patients because it increases the chance of tachyarrhythmias quite significantly, and even non-significant increase in motility were found in various studies, and various other side effects are also there. So dopamine should not be used. Now, at times you may be requiring an inotropic agent as well. This is mainly you will find when you have a patient in shock, persistent shock despite fluid resuscitation and vasopressors, and lactates are increasing, cardiac output is decreasing. So you suspect myocardial failure. In those patients, you add dobutamine. All these guidelines of vasopressors, fluids and inotrope therapies are largely extrapolated from the data available with the surviving sepsis campaign guidelines arising out of management of septic shock. Now, regarding the various investigations in the ICU and imaging studies, I would like to state that the point of care ultrasound will become very, very important in the management of this patient population. This is because predominantly they will be hemodynamically unstable and they will be suffering from ARDS on mechanical ventilation strategies. Now, chest X-ray you can do maximum once or twice a day, but you cannot use it as a dynamic parameter of management. So the point of care ultrasound will be very, very handy. Moreover, shifting these patients to CT scanner will be almost impossible. If you do not have a CT scanner available in your ICU, you need to have a separate COVID corridor, probably separate lifts, and the CT scan CT scanner area has to be decontaminated, disinfected once this CT scan has been done in COVID-19 patients. Moreover, all this will lead to more and more consumption of PPEs and more manpower. So use point of care ultrasound more often than not in the management of these patients. So I would like to just mention the few salient points which you need to remember. What you can do with the use of POCUS in ICU in these patients. You can check the volume status of the patient by simply scanning the IVC. You place the subcostal echo probe or the curvilinear abdominal probe in the subcostal window and have a look at the IVC, whether they are full or they are empty. A quite full IVC with less movement will suggest patient has got good volume status, whereas a kissing IVC will suggest that the patient is probably fluid depleted. So just by looking at the IVC will have good idea of such patient's volume status. However, in the mid zones, you can use the M-mode through it and calculate the IVC collapsibility or the distensibility index depending on whether the patient is on spontaneous breathing or controlled ventilation. And that will give you the idea of whether to go ahead with the further fluid resuscitation or not. Regarding cardiac dysfunction, you can easily identify with the echo probe in four-chamber fuse how the heart is functioning, how is the contractility. Even if you do not know the exact calculations of, say, fractional shortenings or ejection fraction, it does not matter. Just by looking at the heart, you can easily identify which heart is moving well and which heart is not contracting well and grossly dilated. So that will give you a gross idea about contractility and the myocardial function of the patient. Similarly, lung ultrasound will also be handy. Majority of the patient will be suffering from ARDS. So if you put a ultrasound probe on the lung and you find this kind of patterns, this vertical lines arising out of pleura and reaching till the bottom of the screen, you will realize that these are the B lines and this is called B profile. Increasing severity of B profile with coalescent B lines suggests that further and further lung edema. So the presence of B profile basically suggests pulmonary edema, interstitial edema, and increasing coalescent B line suggests alveolar edema. So you can not only use this therapy to diagnose pulmonary edema, but also titrate your therapy, your fluid management strategies, your mechanical ventilation strategy. You calculate the lung aeration scores in all 12 lung zones and follow it up with your PEEP titration or recruitment maneuvers or prone positioning, and subsequently find how they are improving. Because doing ABG very frequently may not be an option if you have shortage of cartridges, and doing chest X-ray regularly or maybe couple of times or more in a day may not be possible. Similarly, many patients will develop significant pneumonia as well, the viral pneumonia or the superadded bacterial pneumonias. So this video shows the presence of subpleural consolidations. The subpleural consolidations in the peripheral area suggest early phase of the pneumonia. As disease progresses, you may have more and more lobes getting affected, and you can see this kind of dynamic air bronchodrums in the background of a consolidated lung tissue. Whereas in further advanced stage, you can have no aeration of the lung at all. The lung tissues is completely hepatized and there is no ailment at all. So you can find at times this kind of pictures where part of the lung tissue above the diaphragm will be hepatized, like looking like the liver in the ultrasound, and part of the lung will be aerated. So all these kind of pictures will tell you how the point of care ultrasound will help you in diagnosing and as well as monitoring the response to your therapy in this kind of patients. Now, don't forget about the routine ICU care. The routine ICU care is very important, particularly to prevent ICU acquired complications in this kind of patients. Now, the basic principles of routine ICU care will remain the same. You always keep these patients in semi-recumbent position unless the patient is grossly hemodynamically unstable. The 30 to 45 degrees of head up tilt should be provided. Don't go beyond 45 degrees because that will increase the incidence of pressure source. DVT prophylaxis is very, very important in this patient populations. Preliminary data coming out of China and Europe suggests that these patients are at risk of developing deep vein thrombosis and even pulmonary embolism. So always use low molecular weight heparin or unfractionated heparin prophylaxis. In a patient who has contraindications of heparin or have bleeding tendencies or actively bleeding, use mechanical prophylaxis in the form of intermittent pneumatic compression devices. Similarly, early use of enteral nutrition is very important. Try to start it within 24 to 48 hours. And stress ulcer prophylaxis should be continued in the form of ACE2 blockers or proton pump inhibitors in high-risk group of patients, like those in mechanical ventilation for more than 48 hours, requiring renal replacement therapies, multi-organ dysfunction syndromes, and coagulopathies. Prevention of pressure source is very, very important. As you can understand, the patients in ICU, majority of them will be in ARDS, they will be in deep sedations and possibly in paralysis. So regular change of positions in these patients to prevent pressure source are very, very important. The patients who are in prone will be kept for 16 hours or so in the prone position. So all the pressure points has to be padded very, very carefully. If you have the gel pads available in your ICU, fair enough. If you don't have them, just put water in the gloves, tie them, and this water-filled gloves, you keep it below the pressure points like your ankle joints, knee joints, elbows, and other areas to prevent pressure source. Glycemic control is very important. We don't need to go strict, we don't need to achieve strict glycemic controls. Just accept a glycemic range of around 150 to 180, that should be good enough. Now, weaning protocols should be placed in your ICU whenever the patient has started improving. You are able to come down on the ventilation setups. Daily sedation breaks and assessment for the readiness to weaning and SBT should always be performed. And whenever the patient improves a little bit, and you should think of starting early mobilization of these patients. Initially, in-bed mobilization and later on out-bed mobilization. Now coming to the next part, the drug therapy. So the data what we have available so far, predominantly from China, suggest there is no specific drug which has really found to cure these patients. So the mainstay of therapy remains supportive. The current drug therapy which have been recommended based on predominantly in vitro studies or our limited clinical experience in these patient populations, or extrapolated from the experience of previous SARS or MERS epidemics, and on the basis of ongoing trials which are being undertaken in multiple countries. So few drugs I would like to discuss here. One is the chloroquine phosphate. The Chinese group initially reported the efficacy of chloroquine phosphate from their data on 100 patients, and they showed that there is significant clinical and radiological improvement as well as virological clearance when they used chloroquine phosphate 500 BD for around 10 days in these patients. Now, hydroxychloroquine can also be used, and the recent paper from France, which have come on 20th March, suggests that the combination of hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin can be very, very handy in this patient population. Now, this French study is not a purely clinical study. It's more like a microbiological study where they used this hydroxychloroquine azithromycin combination versus hydroxychloroquine alone and standard care in 40 patients who were suffering from URI or LRTI of COVID-19. And if you see the data, the virological clearance was achieved almost all patients who were on hydroxychloroquine azithromycin combination versus the patients who are in hydroxychloroquine alone did not achieve such virological clearance, and very very few patients had virological clearance who were not receiving either of these drug therapy. So this suggests that there may be some role of hydroxychloroquine sulfate as of now. Now the another important drug combination, the antiretroviral drugs, lopinavir-ritonavir combination has also been tried. And again, we have data from China, which was published in NEJM on 18th of March. In their study, they did an open label RCT in 199 patients who were randomized to receive either lopinavir-ritonavir combination or the standard of care. And this was done in all hospitalized patients with low oxygenation and low PaO2 FiO2 ratios. Now the primary outcome was time to clinical improvement, and the other secondary outcomes were mortality, ICU stay, or the viral load. Now here, remember that the lopinavir-ritonavir combination cannot be used in patients who have advanced cirrhosis, who are already suffering from HIV, because there is fear of developing resistance against these drugs in those patients. And people who are on already medications, like say rifampicin or voriconazole, which cannot be stopped, and this presence of these medications are contraindications to the use of lopinavir-ritonavir combination. This Chinese data show us that the primary outcome, time to clinical improvement, was median 16 days in both the groups, so which was not statistically significant at all. However, three patients had died early within first 48 hours in LPVR group. So excluding those three patients, when the modified intention to treat analysis was done, there was one day benefit was found in time to clinical improvement. However, the clinical benefit of this only one day remains questionable. If you see the mortality data, there was no significant difference in the percentage of population died on this in the study. However, it's interesting to found that in a group of patients in whom this LPVR combination was started within the initial 12 days from the symptom onset had numerically much less mortality compared to the standard care. So this gives us a message to do more studies where LPVR combination may has to be started much earlier. By the end of 7 days or 10 days, you have to take a call whether you are switching over these patients into LPVR combination. Now, there was also significant improvement in the ICU length of stay with the use of lopinavir groups, but the virological clearance almost remained same as the standard group. Now, following this trial, the ICMR has already started a nationwide study, the randomized controlled trial in symptomatic hospitalized patients by with the use of this lopinavir-ritonavir combination for 14 days. And they're looking at these outcomes like mortality, length of hospital and ICU stay, various side effects and viral RNA load. So if you have to use lopinavir-ritonavir combination, you have to contact ICMR as of now in India. Now, beware of important drug interactions. Like in hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine, the concern is QT prolongation and hypoglycemia. So if your patient is already on certain drugs which are known to cause QT prolongation, like azithromycin, levofloxacin, or if you have heart failure, your baseline QT is already prolonged, then it's preferable to avoid all these medications. Lopinavir also have significant drug interactions with few drugs which are commonly used in ICU, like fentanyl, midazolam. So have to be very, very careful when you're using these drugs in your ICUs. Now, based on this available data on the drug therapy in the AIMS, in our protocol, we suggest to the patients to start on hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin combination initially, and if they are not tolerating it or there is some contraindication or patient worsens on this therapy, then we'll switch over to lopinavir-ritonavir combination as per the ICMR protocol. Now, talking about certain adjunctive therapies. Now, corticosteroid has always been controversial in various managements, and here also it is not without controversies. There is an initial publication from the China in non-peer-reviewed journals that use of low-dose corticosteroids like methylprednisolone 1 to 2 mg per kg per day have shown improved clinical profile of the patient as well as radiological improvement in CT scans. However, the previous experience with the use of corticosteroids in SARS and MERS outbreak and the synthesis of these studies in the form of systematic reviews by the Cochrane groups and meta-analysis performed and published in various other critical care journals suggests that use of systemic corticosteroids in viral pneumonia and ARDS patients did not have any survival benefit. Moreover, it increases the chance of secondary infections and delayed virological clearance. So there is a potential that the patients who have already recovered can continue to spread this virus because of this delayed clearance, even if you have discharged them from the ICU. So based on this, WHO strongly recommends not to use systemic corticosteroids. The Surviving Sepsis campaign guideline released earlier had advocated that the systemic corticosteroids can be used, but the WHO guidelines go against this. However, it's important to know for everyone that if the patient is already on steroids for some other indications, you can continue it or even use it for refractory shocks when the shock is refractory to your vasopressor therapies. Now, there are initial reports about the use of convalescent plasma from patients who have recovered from this COVID infections. Now, this has already been tried before as well in SARS infections, in influenza pandemics. However, in MERS and Ebola outbreaks, these convalescent plasmas were not effective. But it was really effective in SARS pandemics, and the meta-analysis published in 2014 showed that there is significant reduction in the mortality with the use of convalescent plasma in this group of patients. So in COVID-19, we have so far data from only 5 critically ill patients, again coming from China, where they used this convalescent plasma from people who have recovered from SARS-CoV-2 infection with high IgG titers. And all these 5 critically ill patients were on ARDS on invasive mechanical ventilation. So all of them, in all of them, the viral load became negative by the end of second week and they could be weaned off ventilator. 3 of them have already been discharged by the end of second month, and the rest 2 are still there in the hospital. So based on this, the FDA has already approved the use of convalescent plasma in the setting of clinical trial in USA. So pending the report of clinical trial, we should not start using all these therapies. Now there are several ongoing trials with the use of various drugs like remdesivir. Remdesivir is an agent which inhibits the viral replication at the RNA transcription level, and multicentric RCTs at as many as 3 or more are going on currently, one in China and others in various countries, predominantly from USA and other countries. The results of these are expected to come in couple of months time. The WHO has launched the Solidarity trial, which is essentially a 4-arm trial where 4 interventions are started simultaneously: the remdesivir, the lopinavir-ritonavir combination, chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine, and lopinavir-ritonavir in combination with the interferon beta. So we have to wait for the results of the Solidarity trial. Vitamin C has got significant anti-inflammatory and antioxidant properties. And in China, they have started a trial with the use of high dose vitamin C for 7 days, and the results are still pending. Similarly, already there is a concern that this viral pneumonia ARDS patients do have significant cytokine storms. So why not try with the interleukin 6 receptor antagonist tocilizumab? So the trial has already been started in USA. So the point is that we need to have more and more trials, and we have to wait for the data or clinical data coming out of these trials. So our researchers will remain busy to find out the effective therapy. The search will go on. At the same time, the clinicians, we should have our armamentarium ready, our knowledge and skills sharpened, and be ready to face the increased surge of patients in our ICUs. So to summarize, early identification of high-risk cases is very, very important. Hospitalize them, and if required, admit them in the ICU based on the ICU admission criteria. The mainstay of therapy will remain supportive. You should be very, very careful about the infection control practices and aerosol prevention strategies. The details will be discussed in subsequent webinars. The mechanical ventilation strategy we'll be discussing again in the separate talk. The hemodynamic support remains very, very important. General ICU care to prevent superadded complications, you must not forget. And drugs and adjunctive therapies will continue to evolve, and we'll continue to use the drugs based on the current evidences and as the situation evolve. So with the continued effort of not only the healthcare providers or the researchers, but also the government, who is trying very hard to reduce the outbreak of the disease, and the continued effort, most importantly, of each and every citizen who is trying to stay back at home and contributing to the mitigation of the outbreak of the disease, all this I sincerely wish that come good, and we are able to wipe this coronavirus off from our country like this. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everybody. Myself is Dr. Vikas Rai, and in the next few minutes we'll be discussing about the ventilator strategy in a COVID-19 patient. We'll discuss this with the following headlines. First, we'll discuss certain thing about the statistics of COVID-19 patients who are admitted into ICU. We'll discuss about the respiratory support, starting from oxygen therapy to invasive ventilation. How to take care of a patient who is mechanically ventilated and COVID positive. What are the disaster management strategy, and how to win and extubate a patient who is COVID-19. As you all know, the disease is COVID-19, and the virus that causes is SARS coronavirus 2. If you currently look into the internet, there are a lot of literature available. However, most of these literatures are either opinion-based or anecdotal report. Mostly, my discussion will be focused on the two guidelines that has recently published. One is the Surviving Sepsis Campaign Guidelines, and other is the WHO Guidelines for Management of SARI. As per all the guidelines, these guidelines have used terms like recommend, suggest, or recommend against as per the level of evidence. If there is a high level of evidence, it is recommended. If there is low level of evidence, it is suggested. And if the evidence not to do the intervention, there is a recommended against. Similar terminology also has been used in the WHO guidelines. Coming to the disease severity of COVID-19, it has been found that 81% of the patient have a non-severe disease, and 19% of the patient develop hypoxemic respiratory failure. Among these patients, 14% required oxygen therapy, and 5% of the patients are admitted into ICU who required mechanical ventilation. Patients who are critically ill and COVID-19 positive, 67% among them develop ARDS, 56% required mechanical ventilation. If you look into the presentation of the COVID-19 patient, you can find out that most of the patients require ICU admission in the second week after the presentation. However, these patients may require oxygen therapy starting from the 5th or 6th day after the presentation. The risk factor for respiratory failure in a patient who is COVID-19 positive are old age, male gender, presence of underlying comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, chronic respiratory disease, malignancy, or immunocompromised state. The case fatality rate, although the data is changing and dynamic, currently the overall fatality rate is around 2.3%. However, those patients who are more than 80 years old, the case fatality rate is around 14.8%. In ICU patients, the mortality rate is 14%, and those patients who are mechanically ventilated, it is even more than 50%. Respiratory support, starting from oxygen therapy, most majority of the patients who require oxygen therapy needed it on the 5th or 6th day after the presentation, and it has been suggested that you always start oxygen therapy when the SpO2 is less than 92%. However, it is strongly recommended to start oxygen therapy if the SpO2 is less than 90% with a target of 92 to 96%. It is recommended not to target a higher than 96% of SpO2, because in studies in non-COVID patients, it has been found that if you target a saturation of more than 96%, there is an increased mortality. The data regarding the COVID-19 group is limited. However, these data can be extrapolated in this scenario. The target SpO2 target is different in the WHO guidelines, where they say the initial resuscitation target is more than 94%. Once the patient becomes stable, you can target for SpO2 more than 90%. Unless otherwise the patient is pregnant, where you target from 92 to 95%. Oxygen or conventional oxygen therapy can be delivered using the single-use oxygen delivering interface like nasal cannula, nasal prongs, simple face mask, mask with reservoir bags. If the conventional oxygen therapy failed, the options available to us are the high-flow nasal cannula, non-invasive positive pressure ventilation, or intubation and mechanical ventilation. There is some confusion regarding the use of high-flow nasal cannula and non-invasive positive pressure ventilation among different guidelines, because there is some concerns regarding production of aerosol using these two methods. However, we'll discuss this one by one. It has been recommended or it has been suggested to start high-flow nasal cannula whenever available, whenever there is a failed in conventional oxygen therapy, and it has been preferred over the non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. High-flow nasal cannula has been found to decrease risk of intubation, and it is much more comfortable for the patient to wear a high-flow nasal cannula. Whereas non-invasive positive pressure ventilation has been associated with increased risk of contamination to the healthcare provider. In terms of risk to healthcare provider, high-flow nasal cannula does not seem to increase the disease transmission. It has been found to be equivalent to the conventional oxygen therapy in terms of contamination risk. In study during the SARS outbreak, it has been found that healthcare provider exposed to high-flow nasal cannula are not as an increased risk for transmission. Non-invasive positive pressure ventilation should be used in a COVID patient whenever the high-flow nasal cannula is not available. The WHO guidelines do not agree with this. They have a lesser recommendation or lesser degree of recommendation regarding use of non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. As per them, this should be avoided and only used in certain patient where there is a negative pressure room or cubicle is available. Regarding the interface, face mask versus helmet, which way to deliver the non-invasive positive pressure ventilation, the data is insufficient and there is no recommendation. Safety and efficacy of helmet with COVID is not known, although logically it seems that the helmet will be a better option in terms of transmission of contamination to the healthcare provider, and it will produce lesser aerosol compared to the non-invasive positive pressure ventilation with a face mask. However, the current guidelines does not give any recommendation, but they suggest you should not waste your resources in buying helmets if you don't have helmet previously. There are certain concerns regarding use of non-invasive positive pressure ventilation in a COVID patient. First is the increased risk of to the healthcare provider, as non-invasive positive pressure ventilation produces aerosols, and it has been found that, and there are certain evidence, there is increased transmission rate to the healthcare provider compared to that of the high-flow nasal cannula or conventional oxygen therapy. There is also increased failure rate whenever it is used in a non-cardiogenic setting, and the failure rate has been found in most studies to be more than 50%. In a study during the MERS outbreak, it has been found that non-invasive positive pressure ventilation failed in 92.4% of cases, and those in whom this ventilation failed, they have a worse outcome. It also increases the risk for delayed intubation and unstable intubation, which again increases the risk for transmission or contamination to the healthcare providers. Whenever you are using a high-flow nasal cannula or non-invasive positive pressure ventilation in a COVID patient, always have a close monitoring for worsening of the respiratory status. Whenever there is a worsening of the respiratory status, there should be low threshold for intubation with intubation with control setting with all the precautions. So if you have a patient who is COVID-19 positive and a saturation of less than 92%, you should always provide a conventional oxygen therapy with a target of saturation around 92 to 96%. If this conventional oxygen therapy failed and you have a high-flow nasal cannula, then consider using high-flow nasal cannula. If you don't have high-flow nasal cannula, then you consider using non-invasive positive pressure ventilation either through a face mask or a helmet, whichever you have. Whenever you are using either the high-flow nasal cannula or non-invasive positive pressure ventilation, always close monitoring for worsening of respiratory status. In those cases, you go for early intubation in a control setting. However, in the beginning, whenever there is the saturation 92% or after the failure of conventional oxygen therapy, you can directly go for intubation with any of the symptoms like worsening oxygenation, hypercapnia, acidosis, high arc of breathing, or mental stresses. The Surviving Sepsis campaign suggests to use or consider using non-invasive positron ventilation whenever the high flow nasal cannula failed. However, the data regarding this is less, or it is less convincing. Regarding the safety when using either this non-invasive methods of high flow nasal cannula or non-invasive ventilation, there are certain strategies that has been described, although the data is lacking. For use of mask over the high flow nasal cannula, there is no data, although some anecdotal reports have been published regarding use of mask over a high flow nasal cannula. Always use filter to limit the transmission whenever using a ventilator or a BiPAP machine. Helmets, though theoretically have the advantage of decreased risk of contamination or aerosol generation, the data is lacking. Awake prone positioning with non-invasive support is a newer thing, and it has been found to decrease the rate of intubation, or it can avoid intubations. In this, the patient itself or positioned himself or herself in a prone position, either with a conventional oxygen therapy or with non-invasive support like high flow nasal cannula or non-invasive ventilation. It required cooperation for the patient with an intact mentation. The physiologic principles are same with the proning with mechanical ventilation, and it has been found in non-COVID patients to avoid intubations. So it may be useful in situation where access to invasive ventilation is limited. If you go with this scheme, the scheme for non-invasive support should be always start with low flow nasal cannula, then go for high flow nasal cannula and CPAP or non-invasive ventilation, followed by awake prone positioning with this high flow cannula or CPAP, then go for mechanical ventilation. So coming to mechanical ventilation in COVID patients, critically ill patients, among the critically ill patients, 67% of the patients require develop ARDS, and as per the classifications of Berlin classifications, it is the moderate or severe ARDS that require the ICU admission or mechanical ventilation. Whenever you don't have a data of PO2, then the ratio of SpO2 and FiO2, which is less than 315, always suggest ARDS and requirement of mechanical ventilation. The data regarding managing a patient who is in ARDS and COVID-19 positive is very limited, although there is certain data available from the Chinese studies. These are not in randomized control manner, and the sample size or number of patients involved was less. However, both the guidelines believe that the standard protocol that are used for managing an ARDS patient which is non-COVID positive will be sufficient and will be equally efficacious in managing COVID positive patients. As per them, if you discuss about the tidal volume, it has been recommended to use a low tidal volume with a tidal volume targeting from 4 to 8 ml per kg of predicted body weight. You always start with 6 ml per kg, and it has been found in multiple studies and systemic reviews, and many guidelines also suggest as it decreases mortality. It is a very low cost intervention and has been found to be effective in terms of mortality. Similarly, plastic pressure should always be targeted to less than 30 cm water. When it is again a low cost intervention and when combined with low tidal volume, the rate reduction in mortality has been found to be good and better with individual results. Use of PEEP is debatable. Higher PEEP, which is defined as PEEP is more than 10 cm water. There has been a lot of studies and meta-analysis, and they have conflicting results. The meta-analysis also does not point towards a certain direction. However, in subgroup analysis, it has been found that in certain group, it may be beneficial to use a higher PEEP. So use of PEEP in a COVID-19 patient with who have ARDS should ideally be individualized. However, the guidelines suggest for a higher PEEP strategy with monitoring of the barotrauma and limiting driving pressure. The WHO guidelines are much more liberal with the use of PEEP, and they don't strongly recommend any use of high PEEP strategy. If you are using a higher PEEP strategy, you can use the ARDS net trials higher PEEP and FiO2 table for adjusting the PEEP. Fluid strategy, as is already discussed, a conservative fluid strategy is always put and suggested. Prone ventilation has been found to be decrease the mortality. The prone ventilation should be at least for 12 to 14 hours, and it has been found that Pruning the patient less than 12 hours does not affect the mortality. However, there are some complications that can be associated with pruning, and those should be taken care of while doing a proper pruning. Neuromuscular blockade use has been suggested, and it has been suggested for using intermittent boluses rather than continuous boluses to facilitate protective lung ventilation. However, continuous neuromuscular blockade infusion for shorter duration, that is less than 48 hours, can be used whenever there is a persistent ventilatory dyssynchrony, need for ongoing deep sedation, prone ventilation, or persistent high plateau pressures are present. Nitric oxide, it is recommended against routine use of nitric oxide. However, it can be used as a rescue therapy. Recruitment maneuvers are previously strong used in all ARDS patients, but now the literature shows that it does not help much. However, if patients are hypoxemic despite optimal ventilation setting, it has been suggested in the guidelines to use the recruitment maneuvers. But staircase recruitment maneuvers are strongly, it is strongly recommended not to use staircase recruitment maneuvers, rather use sustained inflation maneuvers. WHO does not give any recommendation regarding recruitment maneuvers. It has been suggested that you can use veno-venous ECMO whenever there is a refractory hypoxemia despite optimized ventilation, or rescue therapies like pruning has been used. But there are certain economical and ethical issues associated with the use of ECMO. Economically, it is a lot of expenses for the patient with ECMO is high, and in a pandemic situation, using ECMO or mobilizing your resources towards ECMO is doubtful. Also, those patients who are on VV ECMO take a longer duration of time, so there are certain issues with use of ECMOs and longer duration of time with the economical strain. So if you want to approach the patient with ARDS, you always have to reassess the ventilation setting daily or at least every 24 hours, and you approach in a step-wise manner. First, after confirming ARDS, you go for the ARDS ventilation strategy, that is low tidal volume, plateau pressure less than 30 centimeter water, and a higher PEEP strategy. If the PF ratio that is decreased less than 20, you can again think of higher level of PEEP. If it is less than 150, you consider neuromuscular blockade or prone positioning, and later you can discuss VV ECMO if you are available, or you can transfer the patient to a ECMO center. So coming to care of the COVID patients on mechanical ventilation, it has been found that you always avoid ventilation disconnection as it will produce aerosols. Inline or closed sections are preferred as discussed, and always clamp the ET tube when disconnecting from the ventilation. As discussed previously, suctioning should not be used hourly basis, and closed suction should be used whenever required. And nebulization and bronchoscopy should always be avoided, and only absolutely necessary they should be done with all the precautions. Disaster ventilation strategy, as with the COVID pandemic, there is a lot of shortage of ventilation, and most of the time the ventilator shortage lead to increase in mortality. So certain disaster ventilation strategy has been described, like splinting the ventilator, outpatient BiPAP machines for intubated patients. Like most of the patients in the community have a BiPAP machines for the obstetric sleep apneas, and those things can be modified to be used in an intubated patient. Lastly, use of oxygen resuscitator, which use a time cycle or pressure cycle based logic to provide certain amount of ventilation to the patients. However, these has not been used in a larger populations. These are only used either in a small populations or in animal studies. However, these are the strategies should be kept in mind, and you should be prepared if required in a disaster scenario. But there is no one size that fits all the solutions. You use the different strategy in different scenarios. Like splinting the ventilator may be helpful whenever the patients are deeply sedated or intubated, and the requirement of ventilation requirement in group of patients are equivalent. How to do the splinting ventilators? There are many accessories required where one ventilator can be used for providing ventilation to more than one patients. Similarly, with use of certain equipments, you can use a community BiPAP machines that can be attached to the entrecal tubes, and it is preferably in those patients who are close to weaning. Automatic resuscitation can be used when non-pulmonary patient is intubated because of the non-pulmonary cases. Come to weaning extubation, the stages of mechanical ventilation patient, that patient after mechanical ventilation goes through remains similar, and the same steps should be used in a COVID-19 patients. You always reassess, give spontaneous breathing trials, and if the patient is extubable, you extubate. So the liberation from the mechanical ventilation has the following pathway. You, after the mechanical ventilation, you always check for the readiness for weaning. This can be clinical criteria, weaning predictors or integrated indexes, and if qualify for weaning, you give a weaning trial. Whenever there is a weaning trial, there are different methods of weaning trial, but spontaneous breathing trial is the most commonly used method and most efficacious method. Hence, there are many methods to provide a spontaneous breathing trial, like a low level of pressure support, automated tube compensation, or a TPS trial. Logically, although there is data is lacking regarding this spontaneous breathing trials manoeuvres in a COVID-19 patient, but logically, if you see, the low level of pressure support is preferable rather than a going for a TPS trial. Weaning trials, if either it may be weaning successful or weaning failed. If the weaning is successful, you consider for extubation, and if the criteria is there, you extubate. If the weaning failed, you find out why the weaning failed, try to correct it, and again follow the weaning strategy. If you plan for extubation, you always look for whether there is a airway obstruction or airway inadequacy, conscious level and adequacy of the cuff. Everything is okay, you go ahead with the extubation with no plus minus of non-invasive support. While during extubation, following precautions are must. You always plan for a gentle extubation. Avoid open tracheal suctioning during extubation. And if the history is less than 2 weeks, always take all the precautions, all PPEs. And if it is more than 2 weeks, you may consider treating it as a non-COVID patient. However, even after more than 2 weeks, there is a chance that the viral load is high and the patient may be infective. So if you have the viral load labels, you always go for the viral load label to find out whether the patient is infective or not. Otherwise, you can take that patient as a COVID positive patient and go for all the standard precautions. So coming to the take home messages, first thing is follow a systematic approach for respiratory support. If you have a high flow nasal cannula, use that, and that is preferred rather than a non-invasive positive pressure ventilation. Consider awake prone positioning if possible if the patient is cooperative and you have.
First question was if the virus can be transmitted through stool or urine. So far, what data is available to us, we must understand that it's a droplet-borne infection, it's a predominantly respiratory virus. So you should take all sorts of precautions related to droplet and practice hand hygiene carefully. There is no solid evidence yet to suggest that this virus can be transmitted via fecal-oral route or any other route. Now, another important question was how to diagnose COVID or suspect COVID-19 in children. Now, first of all, we should understand that as far as the data is available so far across the countries, it rarely affects the child. So the incidence of COVID population presenting to your hospital will very, very rarely consist of children. Even then, the standard symptomatology are similar, like people will present with fever, respiratory distress and cough. If you are not a routine pediatric clinician, then you must remember the different tachypnea respiratory rate cutoff criteria for diagnosing respiratory distress in an infant or a child. It's all already uploaded in the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare website. The respiratory rate more than 60 for an infant with less than 2 months age, respiratory rate more than 50 for an infant with 2 to 11 months of age, and from 1 year onwards, child respiratory rate more than 40 should be taken as a cutoff criteria for tachypnea. Now, there was an interesting question if this same fluid management strategy that I told, like restrictive fluid management strategy, holds good in cases of dengue as well. Now, dengue shock syndrome, when it presents, the patients will be very, very dehydrated and in shock, and they require fluid, obviously more fluid than you would envisage to administering a patient with COVID-19. However, even then, you should remember that a dengue shock syndrome, patients will have leaky capillaries and you should not give too much of fluid. So it's not liberal, but you should not be too restrictive as well. So you should have certain guides. If you have the dynamic parameters available, again, you guide with that in your ICU, or else in the initial phase, you guide with urine output. That's the best important predictor. In adults, it should be at least 0.5 mL per kg per hour. Investigations we should do. Now, when a COVID-19 patient who is critically ill and suffering from ARDS or shock in your ICU, you will do all standard investigations that you otherwise do. Now, apart from that, here you need to do proper swabs to diagnose the SARS-CoV-2 virus in respiratory samples. Now, the recommendation is that in a patient who is intubated, you will take two samples. One is endotracheal tube aspirate and the second is nasopharyngeal swab. Now, this endotracheal tube aspirate, as I said, should be obtained with full aerosol precautions, like with the closed suction devices. If your patient is non-intubated, then also you take two swabs. One is nasopharyngeal swab, another is oropharyngeal swab. And as far as the data available to us, there are a few lab parameters which have been found to poorly prognosticate the outcome of these patients. Among them, few are high neutrophil lymphocyte ratios. There is consistent lymphopenia have been observed in these patients. Elevation of D-dimer, elevations of ferritin levels and LDH levels have also been associated with poorer outcomes. So whenever you have the facilities available, you can do these lab investigations as well, apart from your routine testing. There was a question on the therapy, hydroxychloroquine azithromycin combination therapy, if they can cause QT prolongation. Yes, they can cause QT prolongation. Independently, these drugs can cause QT prolongation, and when they are administered in combination, definitely there can be QT prolongation. So you have to be very, very careful and regularly monitor the ECG of these patients to find out if they are having significant QT prolongation or not. And you particularly have to be very, very cautious in those group of patients who have risk factors for that. For example, patients who are heart failure, who are hypertensives, or who are having some disease for which otherwise they are on certain medications which can prolong QT intervals. Related to this, another question was if HCQS and lopinavir-ritonavir combination can be co-administered. Now, there is so far recommendation is that if you are considering lopinavir-ritonavir combination, you have to stop HCQS, because the LPVR combination is known to significantly increase the plasma concentration of HCQS, and by that it can increase the level. Now, there will be a few questions on ventilation strategies as well. Dr. Bikash will address them.
There is an interesting question flying, what is the difference between the ARDS in a COVID patient and the normal viral pneumonia ARDS? The main difference is that the ARDS that is developed in a COVID positive patient, in that case, the lung is found to be have a normal compliance. The compliance is decreased, but not that of the non-COVID ARDS. So the main pathology is that there is a high level of peripheral atelectasis with the flooding of the alveoles. And so not grossly this affect the management, but maybe there is a theory that a high airway pressure may be beneficial in managing the ARDS that is due to the COVID-19 rather than some viral pneumonia. Another, there is few questions related to transport ventilation can be used during COVID-19 patient or not. Mostly, as you know, all the patients who required ventilations are develop ARDS in COVID-19, and the ARDS management required a high precision level of ventilation with direct volume, plateau pressures, what are the peak pressures, plateau pressures, what are the peep given. So the transport ventilators does not have these things. So it is very difficult to titrate the FIR to give a higher peep or use some new modes or ventilator or adjust the IE ratios. So, but however, in a disaster scenario, if you have lack of resources, you have a ventilation that can be used, these things can be used, or it can be used as a bridging therapy till you have a proper ventilation or proper ventilator available. Otherwise, standardly, if you have the ventilators,
directly using a transmitter is not advisable. Similarly, there is another question whether the OT ventilators or the anesthesia machine ventilator that can be used for this purpose or not. Again, their OT ventilator now, most of the European many of the European companies are using the OTs at ICU, and they are using the anesthesia machine ventilator for the ventilating patients who are COVID positive. But however, there are certain concerns that should be taken care of before you start using this ventilator. The main concerns are that, first of all, the supply of oxygen, air and nitrous may be variable in different settings. Also, checking the ventilator every day is not possible because you have to change. Once the patient is on ventilation, that will be for a prolonged time. In the OT ventilation, most of the time, their standard thing is that it should be at least checked every 24 to or 72 hours in between. So that is one of the concerns. Another concern is that the level of flow that is required mostly to ventilate the ARDS that will be given by the anesthesia ventilator will be higher. So which in the ICU ventilation, the flow can be adjusted. So managing a high flow is a concern. Use of soda lime again is another concern. So there are a few concerns, but however, this can be used with certain modifications or change your technique. If in a disaster scenario, normal scenario, you should not go for ventilating this patient with the ICU ventilators. Then Dr. Darling will take care of a few questions.
There are a few questions regarding the safety of healthcare providers. One important question which is consistently being asked is that about HCQS prophylaxis. So who should take HCQS prophylaxis? ICMR has already issued a guideline and it's very clear that healthcare providers who are directly working with suspected or confirmed COVID-19 patients only will take the HCQS prophylaxis. And if a confirmed COVID-19 patient is in home isolation, then the direct high-risk contact of the person of that COVID-19 affected person will take HCQS prophylaxis. No one else will take HCQS prophylaxis as of now. And the dose for them is that it's 400 milligram twice a day on day one, followed by 400 milligram once a week for 7 weeks for healthcare providers. Now, few questions were there regarding PPEs. So one of them was that what kind of PPE we should use during point of care ultrasound. Now, point of care ultrasounds will be done always in the bedside, patient in the ICU. So patients will never be, you know, shifted out for doing an ultrasound. Otherwise, we could have easily done CT scans. So for that, the standard PPE which will don and go inside the ICU will remain with you only. So you'll be taking that standard precautions. However, remember that doing a POCUS is not an aerosol generating procedure. You have to be particularly very, very and extremely careful if you are doing an aerosol generating procedures. Now, how long a person can wear a PPE? That was another question. Now, it depends on your roster, the shifts in which you are working on the strategy. So, the basic concern is that once you have donned a PPE, you have to complete your shift of duty and then only you can doff. So, it's advisable that you take adequate amount of water and food and don the PPE and then go inside the ICU. Of course, use in washroom before that and then only you go to the ICU, because you can't come out and can't change as long as your duty is over. So it may be around approximately 6 hours duty or so, if not more. And another question was that, was very important question, that if a healthcare provider who is already in PPE gets exposed to a confirmed COVID-19 patient, but it was not a proper PPE or there was a breach in the PPE. Now, here it's very clear that if an healthcare provider who is exposed to a confirmed COVID-19 patient without any PPE or there is a breach in the PPE which is subsequently discovered, then you become an asymptomatic high-risk contact. So you become a COVID suspect. So in that case, you have to be in isolation, preferably in home isolation if you are asymptomatic, and if you develop symptoms, then you will obviously visit your hospital. Now, when you are in asymptomatic contact and isolation, then you will be tested once between 5 and 14 days from the time of exposure.
There is a few questions relating the use of different ventilator strategy or ventilation splitting. There's a question whether sharing of ventilation is required or can be done or not. Although the guidelines I discussed does not comment anything regarding the sharing of ventilation, this is a new thing that has been quite popular since the COVID pandemic started. Although it's not new, it was first described in 2006 and then also in 2013. Currently, it has been practiced by a Belgian group and a group from the Colombia who have some specific guidelines how to use how to split the ventilator and use it in multiple patients. Although 3 days back, there is a statement from the Society of Intensive Care Medicine, ASA, American Society of Respiratory, to not to use ventilator and split ventilator to use for more than one patient. And in that, there are few concerns, around 9 to 10 concerns. But most of them, if you want to use this, it should be only used in a disaster scenario, and it should be used in a logical way, like that has been published from the Colombian group. It is only to be used with the pressure control ventilations with upper proper sized one directional valves and triggering of the trigger modes. So that is a controlled ventilation only with pressure control ventilations, and you try to group, you ventilate a group of patients who are having a similar ventilator requirement. That is the suggestion they have given. Although again, as there is a statement from the society, it should not be used. But however, if you want to use this, it should be only in the last resort as a disaster management strategy. And the one strategy, as I told, is not fit for all. You have to find out. Mostly this splitting of ventilator can be used for patients who are deeply sedated or requiring higher FIO2 requirement, those scenarios. Practically, it has been used only in small number of cases.
Yeah. So, to sum up, I would like to state that all of you should follow the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare guidelines, ICMR guidelines and WHO guidelines. And do not get biased with any other things. We'll have another, there are a lot of questions in aerosol generating procedures as well and few other aspects. So there will be a subsequent webinar on Friday at 12 o'clock. There will be two topics. One will be how to rapidly prepare an ICU. And second one will be the management of aerosol generating procedures in ICU. So till then, thank you. And I wish you good luck. Thanks for watching.
Thank you.